Sounds a bit quiet.
Myself and Mary have been down Coffs Harbour Way for a couple of weeks. We spent a couple of weeks by ourselves in this lovely place that a lady down there, Rachel, her name is, owns, and she allowed us to use that place for a week or so by ourselves, which was really great, and that enabled myself and Mary to deal with quite a lot of things emotionally. And then we had a group of four mediums fly up from Melbourne and spend 3 or 4 days with us, so that was interesting. They then flew home. And then we did a seminar down at Coffs Harbour. There were about 80 or 90, maybe 90 people there or so. And they asked me to bring their love back up to you. So that's what I'm conveying to you now. So it was good. We were talking about, they had a lot of questions that weekend about emotional processing and emotions, and so I answered a lot of questions about those things. You'll notice I've got a bit of a different sound system hookup. Yeah. So, did someone say very sexy? I don't know how that works, but anyway. I've never seen a sound system have sex, but anyway. It's just in its teething stages, so you'll have to bear with us if things go wrong with it. I haven't got used to it myself yet. I'd like to also thank you guys for the donations you've given over the last few months, and also want to convey to those people who watch the DVDs too that I'd like to thank them for their donations. There's some people are now donating through the internet, through PayPal and things like that, and so I don't get a chance sometimes to personally thank them for those donations with the amount of other emails that come through, our email traffic that comes through. When we go away and have a week holiday, there's usually a couple of hundred emails after that. And so it's very, very much nowadays fairly impossible for me to answer your personal emails. So I've personally given up trying doing that. Mary hasn't given up trying, and that's why many of you, many of you still get a reply from Mary. Today's subject, I'm going to talk about the human soul again, but there's a subject that I want to raise with you. So let's write down the subject. It's part of the human soul series of talks that I've been giving. And this one's, I'm going to title, The Battle for Your Soul. Because I can feel that quite a lot of you feel now that you're in a battle for your soul. Is that not the case? Yeah. And what I'd like to do is be able to describe to you what's actually going on and why these things are going on and how it all works. But before I do that, I want to give you a little bit of background information. The background information applies to 2,000 years ago. And it's interesting how many of the things that happened 2,000 years ago are getting repeated back on Earth again now. And there's reasons for that as well. 2,000 years ago, a group of spirits in the spirit world who were quite organised, who were in a malevolent condition, a very dark condition, decided very early in my life in the first century to actually do everything they could possibly do to make the Earth stay in the place where it was 2,000 years ago. So the place where the Earth was in 2,000 years ago was much darker, if you can believe it, than it even is now. You could liken it, in terms of its general condition, it was a hellish condition, really. So if you're looking at the spheres, the dimensional existences, it was basically in the lower realms of the first sphere, the Earth's personal condition. When I say the Earth's condition, of course the Earth doesn't have a soul, so it's not the Earth's condition, it's the sum total of humanity's condition on the Earth that determines the general aura or the general feelings that you get from the Earth. Now, what happens spiritually is this general condition is like a greyish black fog or mist that is over the entire Earth. And the primary or dominant emotions that are on the earth are fear and rage. Right? And these emotions in particular, along with lots of others, cause a very black and dark condition to surround the entire atmosphere of the earth from a spiritual perspective. When you're a spirit, you actually see it as a physical mist of black or darkness. If any of you have read the book Through the Mists by Robert James Lees, you'll realize that the mist is actually the emanation or the odor, if you like, of our collective soul condition here on earth. Does that make sense? That's the mist. And that's the thing that creates a lot of our difficulties. Now, the reason why it creates a lot of our difficulties is because it's the general atmosphere that we have to get through before we deal with anything emotionally. Right? So there's this mist surrounding the entire earth, which is actually a very, very dark condition, mostly containing these two emotions, but then of course surrounding those emotions are other emotions that also create us staying in the same location. So emotions such as doubt, for example, particularly doubt that God exists and doubt that God is good, and all of those kind of emotions cause the same emanation of odor, or it actually, when you're a spirit, you can smell it and feel it. Right, so it has a smell and it has a feeling that you feel as you come through it, which is the emanation of the collective emotions, the collective emotional condition of every single person on this planet. Does that make sense? And by the way, it's not just every single person on the planet, but it's every single spirit who's earthbound is also contributing to the collective emotional condition. Now, that being the case, basically, if we drew it, oh, is that somebody's phone? It's just interfering with my sound system as well. If you could turn off your phones, that would be great. So here's you here on Earth, let's say. So what we could say is we're sitting here on Earth and we have our own emotional condition to deal with. So there's what is called our own soul condition that I've been calling it, which is the sum total of all of our beliefs, all of our passions, all of our desires, and all of our entire emotional condition has an energy, has a force. And this entire emotional condition, which we could call our soul condition, determines all of our personal law of attraction and everything else that's going on in our life. So most of us are aware of that now that we've listened to many of the talks. So there's this personal soul condition we have. Then there's this cloud, if you like, surrounding the entire earth of humanity's soul condition. Now, while my condition matches closely to humanity's condition, I will feel relatively happy because I'm not receiving any opposition to my own condition. Does that make sense? So I'll actually have a feeling of relative contentment or happiness generally. The more I try to buck against humanity's soul condition, the more I feel the pressure of humanity's soul condition. Does that make sense? So let's say you try to get yourself from firstly being sort of similar to humanity's soul condition, which by the way is in a low first sphere condition right at this moment, and you try to raise yourself to a high first sphere soul condition by dealing with a whole group of emotions. What happens is now you've got the pressure of humanity's soul condition working against you doing that. Does that make sense? Straight away, humanity's soul condition is in opposition to what you're trying to release so that you can accept new beliefs and new constructs within yourself. And the human soul condition is almost like an opposition or a barrier you've got to barge your way through before you can raise your own condition. Now, on top of that, we've got in the first sphere of the spirit world, we've got all of these male and female spirits who have passed from the earth, so I'll draw quite a lot of them across here like so, who are in what you would classify as a hellish condition. Now, when I say the word hellish condition, we're not talking about the fire and brimstone of the Christian beliefs, but hellish condition in that if you met one of these people, you would actually assume that they're the devil that the Bible speaks about. That's how bad their condition is. That's how lacking in love their condition is. If you could see them physically, you would see them and probably in most cases be terrified. This is one of the main reasons why many of us turn off the gift of mediumship in our childhood, because sometimes we see some of these spirits, right? And then as a result of seeing these spirits, what happens is we get terrified because of that. Does that make sense? All mobile phones off, please. The next time a mobile phone goes off, you will go as well. Thank you. All right. So this hellish condition of all those spirits. Now, they also do not want. They also do not want you to change. Right? And in fact, they would like the earth to get into a worse condition than what it currently is. Right? Now, the reason why they would like that is because the only way for them to work to get any emotional satisfaction at all out of their entire existence is to have people on earth they can control and manipulate to do what they want that they can no longer do while they're in the spirit state. And so they want people in earth to get dark again, to go black as possible. Right? And in fact, they spend a lot of their time looking for people who are black to try to make them blacker. Right, to make their condition so dark that they then influence other people on the earth to get dark as well. They're the kind of spirits who want the world to remain in terror. They want you to remain terrified as well. They want you to remain in a rage. They don't want you dealing with a single emotion in a positive way. And they certainly don't want you to become loving. Right? In fact, not only do they not want you to become loving, they are going to do everything possible in their power to get you to become more unloving. That's their goal. And it's a very self-serving goal, and they feel they get joy out of it. In fact, it's the only joy they have in their existence. It's the same kind of joy that a person on earth who's a torturer gets out of torturing his victim. That's the kind of joy they get. A sense of satisfaction. They even sexually get off on the joy of it. Right? So they have a lot of very, very dark emotions, these groups of spirits. Now they are there impressing their condition onto you as well. So can you see already why you're starting to feel like it's a bit of a battle? You've got your own condition, which is sometimes bad enough to deal with it. Like when I began my own journey, I was in a suicidal state. So my own condition was bad enough, let alone having to deal with the condition of the human soul condition and then, of course, the spirits in a hellish condition. Now, of course, there's also these natural love spirits above that. Who are in various conditions of what we could rate from the second dimensional existence to the sixth dimensional existence, which is the pinnacle of a development of a natural love spirit. And they are also impressing their belief systems, their ideas, their knowledge, and all of those things onto the earth. But of course, they have the same problem as every other spirit who's in a good condition has, of getting through all of this darkness through the mist, if you like, that surrounds the planet and therefore surrounds us living here on Earth, to actually influence us. So when one of these spirits up here try to communicate with us on the natural love path, they're going through all of these different conditions to get to us. And in the process of going through all of those conditions, obviously there's a modification of some of the thoughts that they're trying to transmit. Does that make sense? Because each one of these stages has a limiting factor. It's like a resistance to the truth coming to be known on earth. Now, there is also these, above that, what you call celestial spirits, right? These are the spirits who are on the divine love path. the spirits that from the eighth sphere, the eighth dimension through to the 22nd dimension who are trying to influence you, right? But they, of course, now, see, you can see what they've got to go through to get to you. They've got to go through a heap of natural love beliefs and ideas and concepts that we've learnt through the entire of our life. Then they've got to go through a heap of dark emotional concepts that we've learnt through our life, you know, many of which pertain to God, but others of which pertain to our own soul and our own life. Then they've got to go through the general human condition, you know, this mist that surrounds the earth of fear, doubt, anger, rage, and all those emotions. And then they can get to communicate to you. Only if your soul condition is willing to receive it. Can you see how many barriers there are now to the communication? And then, of course, way above all of that, we have our heavenly parent, who actually is totally capable of a permanent connection with you individually. So that heavenly parent is totally capable with the connection to your soul, but can you see what that parent's got to go through to really connect with you? So all of these other belief systems and all of these other conditions and the emotions and our own emotions all add up to a large amount of resistance in our soul to really ever becoming at one with God. Can you see that? That's the truth. So while God is certainly able to barge her way through all of that, to do so she would have to break her own laws of free will. So she's not going to break her own laws. God doesn't create a law just to break it. Right? So the truth is that actually God will not break the law of free will on every one of these people in order to communicate with you. In fact, it would be a very unloving act if God chose to do that. Does that make sense? So God doesn't choose to do that. Just my ear's too big for this thing. It was funny yesterday. I checked, we were doing a bit of magnetic imaging, you know, the MRI scans that Luli is doing anyway. And I get in there and my nose is too big for the... anyway, I was just laying there and my nose is being pressed down by the lid of it. You know. Anyway, which is... my ear is too big for this thing too, so I just have to get that right. All right, so can you see there's a lot of barriers to truth and love being entering your soul as a result. And not only are they just physical barriers, but they're actually, in some parts of the universe, direct opposition to you ever getting into this condition of at one with God. Right? Now, in the first century, a group of spirits noticed that when I began connecting to God directly, what happens on earth when somebody on earth starts connecting with God? It's sort of like a great big supernova going off. If you can imagine a huge bright burst of energy going off. Every time you actually connect to God, this happens as well. But if you imagine somebody in that permanent condition, then it's like that bright energy all the time. Now, everyone around that knows that it's there. Even on earth, people can feel it from you. But spirits in particular can see it happening. And a whole group of spirits in this hellish condition decided that what they're going to do is spend the majority of their energy and concentration on time attacking the persons who are in the brightest condition. Right? And the reason why they want to do that is because these persons are the ones who are having an effect on the earth. So while you are all here and you're allowing yourself to connect to God and receive some love while you're here. Oftentimes that's the case as you're receiving truth. The whole energy here is very bright. So spirits can see it from the opposite side of the earth. They can see how bright it is and they come and visit to investigate. Now there are a whole group of spirits who are in this condition who know that that brightness means their peril is the way they see it. Their death knell is the way they see it. Does that make sense? And what they're going to do is they then zone in on every single person who's in a brighter state, and what they do is they try to get you back into a state that's the same as the earth or worse. That's their goal. Can we just have a mic at Ivana there?
Can one spirit be attached to more than one person?
They will go from person to person to person, often influencing whole groups of people. And it's not just one spirit here. These are like whole groups of spirits who are in this state.
Yeah, so if, just say, there's a negative spirit attached to me, mm-hmm. hooking into my stuff that I'm denying.
Yep.
Can that one spirit not affect another person at the same time, or?
No, they can. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
They can. But obviously, if they're attached to you, that's very different than their attempts to influence you generally. So direct attachments are due to emotional addictions inside of ourselves. What I'm talking about here is not a group of spirits who are directly attached to you, but rather a group of spirits who you would call the rulers of this world. They are the rulers currently of this entire system of things that we're living in. Right?
Okay, I didn't realise there was a difference between a spirit being attached and then a spirit just influencing.
Yep. A spirit being attached to you is very much about your own addictions and their addictions being met. So the only reason why a spirit would be personally attached to you is because you have an addiction of some kind, whatever that addiction may be. Let's say, give an example, the addiction might be that you have an addiction where you always do what the man wants you to do, no matter what the circumstance. And what will happen is different types of spirits will connect to you permanently in that regard. Some of them who are women in the spirit world who believe they also have to do everything that a man wants to do in every circumstance, and they permanently attach to you. That's not these group of spirits that I'm talking to. Those groups of spirits are directly affected by your soul condition, and the instant you raise your soul condition and release the emotion, the attachment breaks, and so they have to leave. There's no alternative for them to leave you. This other group of spirits are a group of spirits who are going to try to influence you no matter what your condition is. They are going to try to attack you no matter what your condition. And in fact, the brighter your condition, the stronger they're going to try to attack you. Right? Because they want to bring you down to their condition or lower.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
I'm finding that the more that I'm processing and releasing, the more I don't want to like put myself in situations like going out to clubs and pubs and all that sort of stuff anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And like I can feel when I'm in a dark space, I can actually feel them just coming in, right in.
To try to influence you to go
totally,
somewhere.
Totally.
Yep.
Totally.
And we'll talk about all of this.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
There are spirits who's like I'm saying, they are not connected to you permanently because you've dealt with different emotions and worked your way through different things. But they themselves are in a hellish condition and they want the earth. Their goal is to have the earth in as hellish condition as what they are. Basically, if you could think of, you know, if you could think of a world, a seedy underworld, if you like, where there's basically public sex, public drugs, everyone's just doing their own thing, murders, rapes, and all those things going on constantly. These spirits would like that happening to the entire planet. They would like there to be just anarchy on the entire planet. That's their desire. So that gives you an idea of how dark they are. And their whole goal is to bring every single person on this planet to that condition. That's their entire goal. Peter, would you like to?
AJ, taking that example where the intent of the negative spirits is to keep humanity in darkness and attached to all of their addictions,
yep.
But that would immediately then bring the law of God onto humanity too, to teach, to bring lessons to that part of humanity
in a
severe way, like Sodom and Gomorrah or something like that.
Of course.
Yeah, and so that would...
There'd be an automatic correctional system going on,
yes.
Which we can talk about which we'll talk about in a minute. But what I'm trying to do is just describe to everyone what's really going on from
yes.
a spiritual perspective first, so that we have an understanding of it.
Yes.
And then we can start seeing what other things are kicking in to correct it,
yes.
to actually bring correction to this system, if you like.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. And one of the things that is most powerful bringing correction to the system is you, actually. And this is why you become the focus of the attack of the spirits, because any person who's in a state who wants to improve themselves immediately has the power to not only improve themselves, but to help others improve as well. So obviously these people then become under more attack from these spirits, or automatically. If we have a mic over there.
Hello. G'day, AJ. I'm just wondering, in the celestial spirit, back, you mentioned earlier on about 2,000 years ago, which you're obviously going to get to more about that in a minute.
Yep.
Where do the archangels play a role in that, knowing that these hellish spirits were around there? And 2,000 years have gone by since their domain and establishment on Earth.
Yep.
How do they fit into it? And are there extraterrestrials from Andromeda? And there's things on the internet talking about you coming here now that, like, they're actually supporting you.
Yep.
But they come from another constellation in the universe, and they know of this time on the Earth. And I'm wondering how they fit into this picture.
No worries. Well, there's two questions there.
Thank you.
So let's ask the first one. Well, who you call archangels actually are just people who lived on Earth prior to your existence. And when I lived on Earth, they were in the sixth sphere condition. Right, so you've heard of the Archangel Michael, for example, the Archangel Gabriel. They are actually people who lived on Earth prior to my existence, and up until the first century, they lived in the sixth sphere condition, and they had a deep connection with God, more so than many others, and God actually used them to transmit truth to the Earth when God had the opportunity. So what would happen historically is people from all walks of life on the earth, not just from Judaism walk of life, so not just a Jew, but all walks of life, they were given prophecies via these spirits, if you like, who were in the sixth sphere condition at the time. Once they learned that the divine love was open for them to receive, they were amongst the first spirits in the spirit world to receive that love. And as a result of that, they then progressed into the celestial spirit world. So after I entered the celestial spirit world, they then entered the celestial spirit world as well. So they now are actually, many of them are in a 22nd sphere state, or in the spheres between the 8th and the 22nd sphere state. You call them archangels. That's not what they call themselves. Does that make sense? And in fact, there are many spirits on Earth currently trying to misrepresent them. So you notice that almost any medium you go to get some channeling, they say, oh, but I have the Archangel Michael here and the Archangel Gabriel here. And many times it's actually a first sphere, very low conditioned spirit trying to impersonate a celestial spirit. And all you need to do is challenge them, and you'll soon see the anger that comes out of them, and you'll know straight away that's not the Archangel Michael or the Archangel Gabriel. The second question you asked was about what you called, like, extraterrestrial beings. There are, in the spirit world, on the natural love side of things, there are literally millions and millions of different spirits who believe themselves to be, and they will say to the earth that they are actually extraterrestrials. What they live in a different dimension. They are not always conscious of the fact that they are in a different dimension, so some are in low conditions. But actually last week I talked to a group of spirits who are in a sixth sphere condition, in that state where they were telling the earth are extraterrestrials. If Mary was here, she'd be able to remind me who they were, but I can't remember. Sorry? The Palladians, that's right. Yeah, the Palladians. There was a group of Palladian spirits who came to talk with us. They came to talk primarily because they told me that they could help me with some of my emotions. And so we had a discussion, and then after the discussion, they actually went off and investigated a lot of divine truth, and then over a period of 3 days, quite a group of them got onto the divine love path. And then they came back and told me they can't help me with my emotions, which was quite disappointing for me. but anyway, so what actually happens in this state is that there are a lot of spirits in the spirit world who have a lot more of a metaphysical way of describing things, and they see themselves as living on different planets, which they are, and they visit the Earth, and they give a lot of truth to the Earth, again, with the same limitations of everybody else, through these filters, right?
So when they say they've travelled so many light years to Earth,
yeah,
it's just a dimensional travel through through them, because they're at the sixth sphere, they're able to tune into the Earth in its poor state and come here and try and help and impress on us a higher style.
Well, the second dimension, for example, is actually hundreds of light years from Earth, right? So I draw it like a line and call it a different dimension, but it's actually hundreds of light years from Earth, which, by the way, if you're a celestial spirit, you can traverse in an instant. So it's like it doesn't even exist in terms of distance. But does that make sense?
Yeah, excellent, thanks.
So there's a lot of metaphysical misunderstanding, I suppose you could say, of what's really going on. But the natural love spirits who are like the Palladians, who are wanting to affect the Earth in a positive way, even if it's in a natural love way, they're in a much better condition than the spirits that I'm speaking of. The spirits that I'm speaking of, these ones in this hellish condition, you could all think of them all as demons, right? In the sense that their entire life is dedicated to your destruction. Now, if you're feeling afraid about that, then deal with some fear about that, because it is an actual truth. But we do need to release our fear about this. Obviously, God is much stronger than any spirit. And in fact, these spirits have very little power unless it's through your unhealed emotion. And this is why your emotional work is so important. We're going to discuss that, how you can actually battle for your own soul. That's the point of this discussion. If we come down here with a mic, there's one just behind you. And then thank over you. To there.
Thanks, AJ.
Yep.
I'd like to thank you. It's interesting that I've turned up today and you're talking about this, because this has a lot to do with what I've gone through in my life.
Yep.
What I wanted to ask you is, I've in the past done some teachings too, and I've let people know about the different influences that spirit can have upon us.
Yep.
You know, a lot of people like to think there's all angels and it's all good out there. Of course, we know it's not like that.
Yep.
The question I'd like to ask you is, many times in my life, I've experienced not only bad influences, but also what I call psychic attack, where I'd get electrocuted by spirits, mm-hmm. or, you know, they could almost take my life, and it seems to last for a few days.
Yep.
So what area or level would that come from? This
group of spirits that I'm talking about are organised against the Earth to actually make the Earth stay in a poor condition. They have a global feel about them. They are like, you could think of them as the rulers of this world. That's what they are. The kind of spirit that you're talking about are more spirits with personal vendettas against a certain type of person. And yes, certainly, a spirit can certainly attack you in such a manner, if you have certain openings emotionally, can attack you in such a manner as to degrade your own condition. And in fact, you can die from their attack. Mm-hmm. The truth is that almost every child that has leukemia who dies is the result of dying from a spirit attack. Mm-hmm. Right? So these things are going on constantly around us. We call them even diseases, like the diseases which primarily affect the pancreas, for example, or the diseases regarding, you know, insulin dependence, diabetes and so forth. A lot of them are all the results of spirit attack. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of even diseases that we've named that are the direct results of spirits being able to attack us in certain ways and in certain areas in our own body. And certainly a spirit can cause your own death, in not just by external means, but actually cause it through your own blockages, through your own emotional condition. So a spirit can certainly harm you quite greatly, personally, if they desire to.
Yep.
And there are many spirits who desire to.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting, just finishing up, because ever since I was a child, I remember a lot of episodes happening to me. So, you know, I've experienced literally thousands and thousands of different attacks when I open myself up spiritually.
Yep.
And I've actually written a book about it to explain to people that it's not all beautiful out there. There are these
exactly
lost souls out there.
Exactly.
Yep.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And many of them are not lost, actually. Many mm-hmm. of them know exactly what they're doing.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't call them lost, no. even. They're very definitely down the evil road, mm-hmm. and they want to stay in that place. And they will stay in that place for a period of time until their own pain, and I'll talk about when it'll stop for them, and that's when their own pain exceeds their desire to do something wrong.
Okay.
So that's the only time they'll stop. And by the way, that's the only time you'll stop doing things wrong too, by the way, is when your own pain from the result of it exceeds your desire to do it. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, and that's when they will stop.
Okay.
Their desire to do wrong is so great that huge amount... if you could imagine the amount of pain they're in, you would be freaked out. From the majority of persons on earth would be totally freaked out about the amount of pain these people are even experiencing. Yep. But bear in mind that God's created a loving universe, and therefore these people are in the most loving place that their soul condition can place them at the time. So they are actually living right now in the most loving place they could be for their own existence, which is an interesting thought, isn't it, really? Yeah. If we can go up to...
When you were saying that about these spirits, I didn't go into fear. I think I've got more fear of talking to you right now than I did. And that really blew me away because I felt a lot of compassion for them.
Yes.
And yep. I don't understand that.
Well, these people are obviously creating horrible lives for themselves. And as their horrible life continues to degrade, obviously a person who's in a position of love would love them quite strongly. So God loves them, and they are in the position they are currently in because of their desires and their passions, and God and the place they've created in the spirit world that they live in is unimaginable for the majority of you. Would never even be able to manage and imagine how bad it is, but it's the best place they could be given the amount of love that's in their own soul at the moment. But it's sad to have people in that state that have so little love in their own soul that their souls have shrunk as to be non-existent almost. That their souls, if you could look at their soul, you see them as like a little shrunken, screwed up seed sort of thing. Like instead of this big light ball, you see them like this little dead. It's terrible to look at. And then if you look at their spirit bodies, most of them can't even keep their spirit body together. So bits of their body flies everywhere. So if you can imagine like bits, their arms falling off and their face skin falling off their face, and this is how they look in the spirit world. And this is where a lot of the movies come from about zombies and stuff. Right? They come from people who have seen spirits in these conditions. Yeah. So yeah, if we go.
Hi, AJ.
How you doing?
Just something twigged when you said that they had a global feel about them.
The ones I'm talking about in particular are not these ones that are individually interested in your life for some individual purpose. Mm. I'm talking about now a group of spirits who have their entire purpose is to globally affect the earth. Mm. And they actually, through fear and terror, help all these other spirits project at you. Mm. So these people are thought to be the rulers of the spirit world in the hills. Does that make sense? The irony is the only way they can control even the spirits who would do a lot of their work for them is through fear and terror. And if the spirits didn't have fear and terror, then none of them would do any of the things that these spirits want them to do.
Mm.
So what I'm talking about is these spirits also control the entire world monetary system at the moment.
That was my next
They control
question.
The entire world economic system. Yeah. Yeah. They control the entire world system of things through their manipulation and control.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah. And David Icke mentions the blue blood race. Is this, are we on the same?
Yeah, thing? There's a lot of misrepresentations of the truth of their condition on Earth. And one is this whole idea that there is a blue blood race of people on Earth who basically will always basically rule the Earth.
Yes.
And but this only happens through spirit manipulation. So these spirits connect to people on Earth who are in positions of power and they heavily influence them into doing things that are very drastic in a negative way and an unloving way towards the Earth and towards you. So the entire monetary system was created by these spirits. They've all spirits who have lived on Earth.
Yeah.
All of these people have lived on Earth, by the way.
And is there a lot, or is it a bit like the monetary system, just a very small few?
No, there is a lot.
There's a lot.
Yeah.
A lot.
Yeah, there's billions of them.
Billions of them. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yep. No, behind you it is, and then they'll come down.
Hello. I was just wondering if you've been able to talk to them or with anyone who's talking with them?
Last week I managed to talk with some of them, and I'll tell you some of their comments as we go. Yep. If you come down. Microphone, thanks. You got to wait for the mic. But it doesn't get recorded.
I just wanted to ask, how do you get there?
Get where?
To that position,
to this place?
To that area.
I can describe that to you as well. So we'll do that in this part of the process. What I'm trying to do at the moment is give you a big overview of what's actually happening, and then we'll start talking about more specific things that are going on, right, in terms of how they get into that condition and why they want to remain in that condition, and then also how that affects you. Because remember, we want to focus this on the battle for, you know, your soul, because this is all part of the battle for your individual soul that's going on. So in the Paget messages, you will notice that James Paget asked me a series of questions about whether I was present on Earth in the First World War and whether I was present on the battlefields, like whether I'd watch what was going on the battlefields. And in my response to him, I said that no, I wasn't present on the battlefields, because they're not the persons that I can help. Right? The reality is that the persons that I want to help are the persons who recognise they're in a battle for their soul, not in a battle for a piece of land. Right? And to recognise you're in a battle for your soul, you already need to have a bit of awareness about what your condition is and what's going on around you and what you want to be. And the persons who are in a battle for your soul, if you're in a battle for your soul, you already recognise that actually there's forces greater than yourself. When I say greater, there's forces like not greater than yourself, but rather there's just a great many forces outside of yourself that actually can influence you in your own progression. And what I want to do is give you a heads up about these influences today, because the future, over the next 6 to 12 months, you're going to receive quite a lot of a barrage from them. Right. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to have this discussion with you. Again, not to cause you to feel afraid, but rather to know what's going on. When you know what's going on, it simplifies the entire thing. When you know what's going on, you can avoid things so easily. But when you hook into what's going on, that's when damage occurs very, very rapidly, and that's what I'd like to describe. Now, a group of these spirits come to us this week while we had some mediums with us, and they talked to us. There was a group of them who have gone through a bit of repentance. They were a group of spirits who, all through my life and Mary's life in the first century, all they wanted to do was to bring us events that would create torture and death for us. And so in the first century, I was tortured on 4 different occasions, not just at my death. And Mary was tortured on quite a number of occasions through her life, as well as her death. And these spirits were the ones instigating and creating those events behind the scenes, using our law of attraction and using the law of attraction of people around us, which I'll describe to you in a minute. And what they did was they created a whole series of events which included my own death. So they actually finished up creating my death through their condition. And then by their ability to manipulate not only the people like the Romans and the Jewish Sanhedrin, but also even to manipulate the people who you would term my disciples from the first century. So my death was actually created by these spirits manipulating a group of my own friends. And that's how my death was created. And what I want to do is talk to you about how that happened and what you can do so that these kind of things don't happen again. Does that make sense? To you or to others. So in the first century, this group of spirits spent all of their life planning and plotting against myself. And I often refer to them, in fact, and there are some quotations of that in the Bible in terms of my reference to these group of spirits. And these group of spirits are very influential in being able to influence people on earth through their unhealed emotional condition. It's only through your unhealed, unloving emotions that these spirits can influence you. If you stay in a place of love and you stay connected emotionally and you own all of your own emotions, it's almost impossible And in fact, it is impossible for them to directly influence you in this condition. But the instant you get out of that and you get into an emotional of denial, now they can heavily influence you, and do oftentimes heavily influence us. Many of you have already, by the way, been heavily influenced by them without even knowing. And I'll talk about some of the events, not specifically, but some of the events that have caused those influences. So can you see, though, at this point, what I'm trying to do is introduce you to the fact that the people who have love, so if we first, obviously, God being the creator of all love, has the greatest love, an infinite love for you. And then you've got the spirits who are in at one-ment condition with God. They also have huge amounts of love for you and also for humanity. But can you see that the spirits in conditions of love have a lot of negative things to get through before they can reach you? Does that make sense? Now, you can make it easy for them or very difficult for them to assist you. By making it easy, what you do is you raise your soul condition and you only ever act in harmony with love and truth, which means you only ever act in harmony with the laws of the universe. When you act in harmony with God's laws, no spirit who is acting out of harmony with God's laws can actually influence you personally. Does that make sense? But as soon as you have an emotion inside of yourself or a belief inside of yourself that's out of harmony with one of God's laws or principles, now any spirit in the universe who is also out of harmony with God's laws and principles can influence you. And the problem on the earth is the likelihood of you getting into a darker condition when you've got out of darkness is still fairly high. Now, there's a very good reason for this, and that is that here on earth, we're still living in this human soul condition environment. Does that make sense? So when you raise your condition from a first sphere condition to a second sphere condition, for example, in the spirit world, you would be in an entirely different environment if you're in the spirit world. The environment would be much more beautiful. Everyone around you would be much more loving than what you're used to before. Everyone around you would treat you quite differently. Now, do you think you'd want to leave that environment very often? Of course not, would you? What you'd want to do is stay in that environment for as long as you can, and many of them do. Stay in that environment for many centuries, actually, before they even make the step up to the next sphere or the next dimension. And the reason why is because it's so beautiful being in an environment where you're loved and every interaction is the beginning of love, like for you. And particularly when your life has been in a hellish condition, if it was on earth, being in that environment is very, very attractive. And so, of course, you'll want to stay there. You'd never want to go back to the hills, would you? You think? Even if it was to visit an old mate that was there, you might want to go back, right? You go, oh, do I really want to visit him that much? You know, like, you know, do I really want to, yeah. So what happens is that in the spirit world, as you progress in your soul condition, your environment immediately reflects to you your changed condition, which has a positive benefit on your soul of recognizing that, oh, there's certain actions that are now harmonious with love. Why would I want to give them up? To give them up would mean going back to the lower condition. So can you see it's highly unlikely that a person in the spirit world who's progressed to a second sphere condition would want to go back and live in permanently in the first sphere again because they go and do something that's out of harmony with love. Does that make sense? And in fact, no one ever does, which is understandable. The problem here on earth is very different though. On earth, we have a raise in our conditions through different emotions that we work through in our connection with God. We're receiving divine love, starts purifying the soul. Our condition raises, but our environment, the general environment of the earth, right, is still in the same condition, which means that we're not living in a personally loving environment surrounding us still. Does that make sense? Now, the amount of pressure on you to get back to the old condition is greater now that you're in the new condition than it was when you're in your old condition, right? And since the amount of pressure is greater, there's a higher likelihood of you succumbing to that pressure the higher you progress. Does that make sense? And it's only when you get to a stages in this development that you would never revert. Now, one of those stages is where you'll never tell an untruth again. That's a very positive state to be in. And once you get to that stage, there are certain places you would never go back to after you get to that stage, for example. But if you had an emotion in you of, oh, I feel embarrassed, right? So I don't say the truth. Now, a spirit can now hook into that emotion of your embarrassment, place you in a situation where you lie to prevent your own embarrassment, and straight away your soul condition has now just gone down a rung again. Does that make sense? Right? And this is the trouble on earth, you see. The trouble on earth is our own emotions become our own negative unhealed emotions become our Achilles heel. They become the thing that we can easily be manipulated. Now, so what often happens in progression is this. A person's in a darker condition. They start learning the divine truth. Their condition ramps up, right? Now they start getting into the second sphere condition. Now what's happening is there's more pressure on them from the environment to get back to their original condition. And unless they have courage and a really deep desire to connect to God, they will at some point go back down. Right? And then you'll feel bad about that and you'll feel terrible about that because you've received some divine love, and so you'll want to go back up again. Right? And then the same emotion will get triggered that got triggered the last time. And if you don't stay in harmony with love and truth in that place, what will happen is the condition will go back down again. And this is what happens for many people on the divine love path on the earth, is they go through this cycle. And their general condition doesn't change very much their entire life on earth, because they get to emotions that they don't want to deal with emotionally, and now they can be heavily influenced by a group of spirits who want them to get back down to the previous condition. And they do succumb to that influence. Now, does any of you have the Paget messages on you at the moment? No? Because I forgot to bring some up with me and I can't remember where I've left mine. Oh, I know where mine are. Oh no, it's okay, I've got one in my bag, so I'll grab that. The reason why I want to get the Paget messages out for you is because I wanted to remind you of the prayer for divine love. Can you remember it? How many of you can remember it, the prayer for divine love? Yeah, thanks. And by the way, if you test this prayer with kinesiology, you'll find it probably rates around the 1500 mark on the Hawkins scale, right? But if you take out this paragraph, it will actually test lower on the Hawkins scale if you take this paragraph out that I want to read to you. And this is the paragraph I want to read to you. Keep me in the shadow of your love every hour and moment of my life, and help me to overcome all the temptations of the flesh and the influence of the powers of the evil ones, which so constantly surround me and endeavour to turn my thoughts away from you toward the pleasures and allurements of this world. Now, when I gave that prayer to the disciples in the first century, I focused a fair bit on that particular paragraph. And the reason why is because every one of us often doesn't realise the amount of pressure there is on our soul to revert to unloving behaviour. I think in future I'll tape this to myself, isn't it? To revert to unloving behaviour. And that part of the prayer is there to remind you that actually you do need some protection and you do need to work through your own emotions that cause you to be drawn back into the world that surrounds you from an emotional perspective, from a love perspective. You see, remember I said too that you would become the light of the world. The light of the world, when you become brighter inside of your spirit form, because your soul is brighter, in other words, you're brighter, you're more harmonious with love, the world, including these spirits, see you more. And as such, they have a tendency then to want to pull you down to their condition again. They have feelings that you could liken to jealousy, I suppose. And they will work on you and work on you as much as they possibly can to pull you down into that condition. All right? So you've got these influences, these two positive influences, obviously God being the most influence if you allow God to be, and then the celestial spirits being the next most influence that are harmonious with divine love. And then you've got all of these influences from the natural love spirits down that are out of harmony with divine love in some way. Right? And all of those particular influences have the potential to pull you back down into the way the world thinks and acts and so forth. Does that make sense? Right? Now what we want instead is to be love in the world, don't we? Rather than to be the same as the world. Right? And to be love in the world, it means that we're going to need courage. We're going to need courage to actually live a life of truth and love, even when no one around us is living that same life. And this is why a lot of the times I've been trying to help you with your emotion of expectation that other people are loving to you. Can you see why I've been trying to help you with that emotion? Because in the end, if you expect other people to be loving to you, your expectations are going not going to be met. Because the truth is that the first group of people who get into a state of love means that everyone else is not in that state. So every time you expect your husband to listen to you, and every time you expect your wife to cook you dinner as an act of love, and every time you have these other expectations, you are actually not being harmonious with love yourself, and you've automatically degraded your own condition. And in that place, people can connect to you. Every time you have an expectation that's out of harmony with love. Even when you expect to be loved, you are out of harmony with love. Because love is a gift. And therefore, by definition, cannot be expected. Does that make sense? So every time I expect even someone to love me, I am out of harmony with love. And now I have left an opening for a spirit who is in a negative condition to harm me in that moment. Even if, as soon as I expect them to love me, right? When you no longer expect anything of anyone else and expect everything of yourself, in other words, you expect yourself to be loving even if nobody else is towards you, then you are going to be the least influenced by spirits or negative people around you. Because no matter what they do, they can't stop you from being loving. Right? At the moment, many of you are easily stopped from being loving because you have expectations that other people love you. And as soon as they don't, how do you feel? You get angry and resentful and hurt and all of those feelings. Well, all those feelings bring you out of harmony with love and therefore out of harmony with the protection of the laws of the universe and therefore, of course, able to be influenced by the attack of spirits who want you to get into that darker condition. Can you see? Every moment you expect to be loved by someone else, you are actually placing yourself in a more dangerous spiritual condition. All right. So, what I want to do first is, does everyone understand this entire picture of what's going on? And does everyone get that there are a group of spirits who are in the hells of the spirit world whose only goal is to make the earth worse than what it is? And therefore, any person who ever has a goal to make the earth better than what it is, what do you think these spirits are going to do? They are going to attack you. Now, many of you have a desire to make the earth better than what it is, yes? And so these spirits are going to target you personally, right, in some way. And if they're not already having done so, they will do so. Fix up this little thing here. Okay. Now what I'd like to do is focus you on what's going inside of you and how that is manipulated by them. Right? So what we want to do is look. So we've seen the general overview. Now what we want to do is concentrate on ourselves and how these spirits can easily manipulate us into doing things that we wouldn't normally consider doing. Yes? Now, what, remember I told you earlier that we talked to some spirits from the first sphere who were with myself, who were trying to cause harm to myself and Mary. And those spirits worked upon the emotions, the unhealed, unloving emotions that were still present within most of the people who were our friends, to such an extent that those people made decisions that they possibly would not have normally made. That eventually, firstly, caused my death, and then caused Mary's, a lot of trauma to Mary, including her rape by some of my disciples, and also her death. Right? So, let's have a look at what's going on emotionally inside of us. So here's us. Probably not a good colour, that one, is it? So here's us. Remember, that's our physical form only, isn't it? Our spirit form is basically the same kind of form, but over the top of that. And then we have this thing called a soul that most people can't see, and in fact no spirits can even see, surrounding our form. Now, that is the real us, and that is a container full of all of these belief systems, emotions, and desires and passions. So if we just write that down, we have a set of beliefs, we have sets of emotions, but we also have desires and passions and longings. And so forth, right? They're all part of the real us. Now, when all of those things, our desires, emotions, passions, and longings, are all harmonious with divine love, there is actually a protective, an automatic protective barrier, not created by spirits, but actually your own protective barrier created by yourself that surrounds you. And no other person in the universe can influence you without your will being involved. Does that make sense? In that place. You could think of it like a great big barrier surrounding your soul and therefore also surrounding your bodies. Right? And the only way now any other person can influence us is through external events that have not much to do with us, except in that they might affect us in the longer term. So, for example, if you're in a state of at-one-ment with God, you have this protective barrier around surrounding you. Right at that moment, not a single spirit in the spirit world can ever implant in you a thought that is out of harmony with love. So it's an automatic protective barrier. Not a single spirit in the spirit world, or person on earth for the matter, can implant in you a desire that's out of harmony with love. They can't influence you in a negative manner. And not a single person in either location, spirit world or here, can actually force you to do anything at all in that place. They can't ever make you do something. They can put a gun to your head and try, but they won't be very successful. Right? Now, your physical body may pass through that event, but are you changed? No, you're still not affected by that action that they took. So there's our true condition. That's the condition we can aspire to, right? Instead, what really is happening is we've got these little holes everywhere in our protective armour. Right? And I've talked to you in the past about protective armour that... So I've talked to you about this condition. So we've got these holes in the field around us, if you like. And every one of those holes is created by either an emotion or a belief system or a desire that's out of harmony with love or truth. Every one of them. So remember I just said earlier, my desire, not my desire, but my demand to be loved is actually out of harmony. So that creates a hole in my protective coating. And that's a hole that becomes an Achilles heel for me. In other words, it becomes a way for a spirit or another person on earth to manipulate in order to control me. So how do I control a hole which is, please love me? Let's say that's the hole. So that is actually out of harmony with love, that demand. Right? And then that creates a hole into my soul, which now a spirit or a person on earth can manipulate. How do they manipulate it? Quite easy when you think about it. They give you love and now they have control of you. Or they give or withhold love on cyclic basis depending on what your reaction is. Right? Does that sound a bit like some of your parents? Yeah. Right? So when I have this please love me emotion that's not healed inside of me, I then have a demand going out. You have to love me to interact with me. And so I'll have a heap of people trying to please me. And the people who try to please me, I actually feel they love me, and so I allow them in my life. But they are actually manipulating me right at that point without me knowing. Does that make sense to everyone? If we have a mic over here.
What you're receiving in that condition isn't love, is it?
No.
You're believing, you're deluding yourself.
Totally. Yep, that is exactly correct.
So how do you buy into that?
Well, it begins in your childhood, obviously, like in the sense that often what happens in our childhood is that we aren't loved. And so then we go through this process of realizing that we have to earn love. And so then we start doing things to get love. And then we realize that if I do more, I get more love. Quotation marks. And so now what I do is I start generating an expectation that everyone around me does things for me, and that's proof that they love me. So it's a cycle of events that have occurred right from our childhood right to where we are now that cause us to have that particular belief.
So there's an absence of distinction between, well, let's say real natural love and manipulative emotion.
All this is basically an addiction. And it's not any type of love, actually. It's just an addiction. And it masquerades as love, but it's not love at all. Yeah. And that's why many times many of you feel somebody's giving to you, and you'll notice this sometimes where somebody gives something to you, and you actually feel like they're trying to take something from you right at that moment. Does that make sense? The reason why is they're probably giving it to you because they have an expectation of something in return from you. Does that make sense? And if you're sensitive at the soul level, you will feel a lot of those interactions. If we go to James, if we have the mic over just down your row there.
Is this the same portal of entry that other spirits who are over-cloaking people can use as well too, even though they feel it's for a benevolent purpose?
Yeah? It's exactly the same portal of entry. Exactly the same. Every time you have an unhealed emotion inside of yourself that's out of harmony with love, it's like creating an energy system that is like a magnet drawing from people on the earth or in the spirit world, drawing those people to you. And you will draw to you, in that location, you'll draw to you two types of people. There'll be people who only love you, quotation marks, doing things for you so you feel loved. Or they'll be the people who do the opposite to try to trigger you emotionally, which is a part of your law of attraction.
And this can also be closely aligned to sexual projection as well.
It is very much aligned to sexual projection. Almost everybody on the planet sexually projects in order to feel love from another person. Yeah. Yep. So, you know, when many of you have gone to Mary's workshops and got called on sexual projection, a lot of it is through this portal. You want somebody to love you, so you project at them sexually so they feel nice about themselves sexually, and then they might give you some love. And the more shame the person has sexually, if you project at them sexually, they'll probably feel better about their own shame in many cases, and they feel like they feel drawn to actually give you more attention as a result. So-called flirting is like the epitome of that. Does that make sense? When you're flirting with another person, what you're doing is you're exchanging sexual energy with them through these portals of that your soul has as injuries, enabling them to project at you and you projecting at them in order to get some combined emotions satisfied, which are all, by the way, addictions, and they are all unloving, every one of them. Yep. For Karen up the back there. If we...
AJ, before when you were talking about love being a gift and you can't demand it, I was thinking back to not that long ago when I realised that I was kind of demanding God's love.
Yep.
And you can't do that.
No, you can't.
But then I was thinking it's more of a request, which is a please love me from God. So is it different when it comes to God?
Well, yeah, and this is a very important question, and I want to spend a lot more time on it in another subject. Many of you actually are demanding things of God rather than asking things of God. There's a very, very different emotion coming out at that time. A demand means that when you don't get it, you feel angry. So every time you're angry with God for not getting what you wanted, you are actually, it's telling you that what you wanted in the first place was a demand. Does that make sense? And the same applies with your interaction with each other, actually, too. So the truth is that when we have a longing for something, it's not a demand, and we won't be angry when it's not fulfilled. Right? But as soon as we feel angry or upset or neglected or hurt, then they are indicators that we actually have a demand and therefore have something inside of ourselves to be healed. Yep. So emotionally healed. Now, for the majority of people, we are projecting hugely at God. I was listening, one lady sent us a song list, as people often do send us things, to listen to for triggering emotions, she said. And we played the first song, and it was a prayer to God, and that triggers her emotionally. And actually, this prayer to God was nothing of the sort. It was actually just a list of demands that God should satisfy, right? Couched in a sad song, so that everybody could connect to it emotionally. And if you did connect to it emotionally, you wouldn't actually be processing any causal emotions whatsoever. You would actually be processing effect-based emotions where you have demands of God instead, right? And this is the trouble with even a lot of the songs that we listen to that trigger us emotionally. They trigger us emotionally because they connect us to our effect emotion, and we start getting into our effect emotion, which, by the way, is the addiction itself. And we don't finish up doing with the causal emotion. For example, the emotion, I feel unloved. Can you see that that is an effect emotion? Why would anybody feel unloved? It's because somebody didn't love them. Does that make sense? Like, how did you feel unloved as a child? Only by your parents not loving you, right? So when you say you feel unloved, while you may be stating a truth of what you feel inside of you, it's actually an effect-based emotion, and you can cry about that emotion for the rest of your life and not release it, because it's not the truth. The truth is that God loves you right now, whether you feel unloved or not. Right? That's the truth. And underneath the truth of you feeling, the truth underneath you feeling unloved is that you were not loved by mum or dad or both. And that's the truth we don't want to feel most of the time. Does that make sense? I don't want to feel that mummy didn't love me. So what I do is I blame myself for being, I just feel unloved instead. That is not the whole of the causal emotion. And you can stay in that cycle for the rest of your existence, feeling unloved, and it's also not the truth. And whenever you get out of harmony with truth or out of harmony with love with any of your emotional processing work, you are not dealing with a causal emotion. Because it's only truth and love that opens causal emotions. Now, you'll notice this a lot in our work that we're doing with people as groups. When I state the truth to somebody, they immediately go into an emotion. Have you noticed that? So in the last group we had down at Coffs Harbour, a lady asked me a series of questions, and I just said, just stop for a moment. Just listen to what I'm saying to you. Your mother does not love you. And she started saying things about, oh, but she thinks she does and all those kind of things. I said, no, stop. And I just said the truth again. Your mother does not love you. Right now, she does not love you. And when the lady allowed herself to feel that, she just started crying. Because that truth connected with the feeling. The truth is her mother doesn't love her even right now. The truth is many of your parents don't love you right now. But we want to believe it's love, and so we skip over a heap of emotions. And we even are willing to feel totally unloved but still not realize what its source is. Can you see? We're ready to feel unloved, like, and we're ready to cry for days on end about how unloved we feel, and still, in many cases, totally unwilling to see that that's because our parents, even right now at this moment, don't love us. And we're unwilling to actually cry about that and accept that truth. You see? And it's when we accept the truth that the real emotions get accessed. And when the real emotions get accessed, your law of attraction changes immediately. Not months and months and months and months and months of crying about a certain issue. Does that make sense to everyone? So what happens is that many of these I feel unloved turn into addictions. Please love me. Right? So this feeling, which is actually an effect feeling, it's a feeling that my parents created by not loving me. That's how they created it. Otherwise, it wouldn't be within me. So they created a feeling inside of me that they didn't love me. I, as a result of their projection, felt unloved. In fact, many of you not only just felt unloved, but you actually felt that your parents hated your guts in moments of your life. You know, you remember when mum or dad got out the strap and lost control with you? You remember those times? When they not only belt you once, but just belt you and belt you until they realized what they were doing? Did you feel loved then? Of course not. Were you being loved then? No, but often they're saying, I'm doing this because I love you. All these false messages, see? And so in that moment, did you feel unloved? Certainly. Why did you feel unloved? Because you were not being loved. In fact, in that moment, you were being hated. In that moment, you were hated by them. They had resentment and rage and anger and fury towards you. They hated your very being in that moment. Because if they didn't, they couldn't do what they just did. Does that make sense? Now, sure, it might have done it because they hate themselves and a lot of other things too. But I'm just talking about your personal emotions.
AJ, could they have started with, what you're saying they're projecting on their child?
Yep.
Could that be because that's what they're feeling about themselves?
Oh, it's always about what they're feeling about themselves. But does me feeling bad about myself justify my murdering you? No. So why do we even state that? So we're saying to it, see, this is what many of us are doing in our emotional processing work with our parents. What we're doing is we're saying, oh, they only felt that way because. And this gets you way out of your emotions. It's a great way to get to avoid a whole group of emotions. There is no justification for unloving behavior. From God's perspective, there is none. No justification for unloving behavior. Ever.
Yeah, I didn't feel I was justifying it.
You were.
Oh, was I?
Yeah.
Okay.
By the question.
Yeah.
By actually saying, oh, but wasn't there... As soon as you do that, you're going into this space of trying to justify why they were willing to treat you unlovingly. Does that make sense? You want to understand why they're treating you unlovingly. Why? Can't we just say they treated us unlovingly and leave it there? Why can't we just leave it there? Because we want to justify their unloving treatment, because we don't want to face the emotion. They hated my guts in that moment. How did that feel? Does that make sense? That's why we're doing it.
Yeah, I'm so pleased to ask the question because it was like I was getting it, not getting it.
Yep, the instant you allow yourself to feel that your parent hated you in that moment, and in that moment they were expressing all their rage, frustration and fury against you, a poor, defenseless person, they weren't even brave enough to go and do it to an adult. That's how lack of courage they had about that emotion. They weren't even brave enough to go and punch their next door neighbour in the face. Instead what they did, right, was get a child who they say they control and is their child, and they have the right to do whatever they want to that child. They get that child, and by the way, I'm including myself in this because I've done this, all right? And I get that child in that space and bang, 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 expressing my frustration, anger, rage, whatever other things that I'm expressing into that child. And that child, what is that child feeling in that moment? That child is feeling hated. That child is feeling terrible right at that moment. Many of you have had hundreds of these, some of you thousands of these experiences. Do you understand? Can you see why you feel unloved? Can you see I feel unloved is the result of this terrible feeling you don't want to feel, and that is that my parents actually hated me. My parents resented me. And by the way, many of your parents did hate you and did resent you. Like many of you women have grown up with a mother who resented you because you became a competition for daddy's love, for their husband's love. Same goes with many of you men, right? Now, this emotion, I feel unloved, comes from the underlying emotion that you were actually unloved and you don't want to accept it, right? You don't want to personally fully accept that you were unloved. And many of us need to feel that emotion, that we were unloved. The majority of our lives, we have been unloved. And we need to feel that these people did not love us rather than just feel unloved. Because feeling unloved is the effect of their actions. Do you follow me? Because some are still a bit confused about that. But when I have this emotion and I don't want to feel this emotion, I will now have this emotion, which is the addiction, the flip side addiction, which is, please love me, please love me, please love me. And any person that comes along and who does the slightest thing out of harmony with love with me, what I believe love to be, I get angry. I get upset. I diss them. I cut them out of my life, cut them out of my will, you know, do all sorts of things in order to prevent that person from ever having my love. Does that make sense? When you are in a space of love yourself, you will not ever desire to prevent another person from being loved by you, right? That's how you feel. But anyway, we have these addictions. Now, if I cannot answer the questions at the moment because we're getting a little off track, because what I want to do is show you that these addictions become your hooks into the world around you and therefore become the way in which the world around you can control you, right? Now, some of you feel that as soon as somebody makes a suggestion to you that you're being controlled. Right? Sometimes we sit down with some people when we talk, and sometimes myself or Mary gets quite animated about a project or whatever, and then the people with us start feeling like we're telling them that they have to be involved in it. Right? Well, that's an emotional injury. Why can't I be animated about a subject that you're not involved in? Of course I can be. And why would you feel like I'm trying to control you or manipulate you into doing something with it? Only through an unhealed emotion, isn't it? Like in the end. So often what happens is we often have these emotions within us that even the hint of a suggestion to us is control, right? And that is another addiction. In other words, the addiction is, I want to live my own life. Now, why would that addiction be there? It's because I have an unhealed emotion that I felt during my childhood that I never could live my own life, right? That I was never allowed to make my own choices, my own decisions. I was always punished when I made a choice or decision. So now I don't want anybody telling me anything. I don't want any suggestion being made to me about my life, right? I'll resist it, resist it, resist it. There's another emotional hook in demand into my environment. Does that make sense? Now that can be manipulated somehow, right? There's all ways of manipulating all sorts of emotions. As soon as we have an unloving based emotion within us, we can easily get manipulated externally. And this is the trouble with us generally as humans. We've got so many of these. Little addiction here, little addiction there, little, you know. I was just about to burst out in song, but I won't do that. The song was totally inappropriate for the occasion. So, all right. So here we have a whole group of emotions and desires and passions in us. Some of them are loving, some of them are unloving. The ones that are loving protect us automatically. That's an automatic action of those loving emotions. The ones that are unloving don't protect us at all. Right? The ones that are unloving really harm us and other people around us. So the problem is that many times we think ones that are loving are actually, but they're actually unloving. So how many of us would have thought the desire to be loved is an unloving emotion before we began this? Right? In other words, or I should say the demand to be loved is an unloving emotion. Most of us would have thought, oh, I've got the right to demand that everyone around me loves me, right? Most of us would have thought that, wouldn't we? And we would have thought that that meant we were being a loving person ourselves, right? Not realizing that that actually is an unhealed emotion that's affecting our connection with God, not realizing that actually, in the end, it's saying that love isn't a gift. It's saying that we can demand love of anybody and receive it, and if we don't, what do? We have a tendency then to punish them because they're not giving us what we wanted. So the whole please love me thing is a huge addiction, and a huge addictions allow our control by others. That's how we get control by others, by having huge addictions. So let's look at some of them. Like if you look at a lot of them, like things like doubt. I've talked about doubt before, right? Doubt is a huge emotion that actually is very unloving to yourself. You need to resolve your doubts. Because when you're in a place of doubt without it ever being resolved, what's going to be happen is you're going to be pushed around so much. Because somebody will come along and say, well, many of you have been out to dinner, right? And you're sitting down, you're looking at the menu. And you can't really work out what you want. Now, many times, if we can't work out what we want, it's because we're not feeling our feelings in the first place. Because if you felt your feelings, you'd know exactly what you want, and you probably wouldn't even need to look at the menu. You'd just say, oh, would you have something like this, that? And they say probably yes or no, and say, well, I'll have that, please. But what happens is we're in this place, and none of it really matches what we want, right? So what do we start doing? What are you going to have? How is this going to resolve the problem? Right. But we do, don't we? What are you going to have? Oh, you're going to have that. Okay. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that looks all right. But you've already seen the menu before and you've already seen that might be all right, but you had some doubts about it in the first place. And you're looking at, yeah, that looks all right too. Yeah, that looks all right too. So what are you going to have again? In this space. What's happening is I am now indecisive. Can you see that? Doubts cause indecision. Indecisive emotions are so easy to manipulate. You notice that? If someone's in a place of indecision, you can just go up to them and make a little tiny suggestion and, oh yeah, they'll go off on that track. It's so easy. You imagine a spirit. You imagine a spirit dropping these little thoughts in your brain. How easy is it to manipulate your indecision? So you're here coming along to these sessions, coming up, I'm still not convinced about the emotional work. I've got doubts about the emotional work. How easy are those doubts to manipulate? Any spirit come along, oh, you don't have to do that. You could do it this way. And before I know it, I'm off on a path. And then 6 months later, I come back and go, oh, that didn't work too well. And then I'm not trusting even that I'm, for some reason, drawn to this knowledge. I'm not even trusting that. Right? I'm going, doubts. And I've got doubts about it. And in the end, AJ says he's Jesus anyway, so that can't be right. So they've got doubts there, right? And so that then causes me to have doubts about all the other things that are being said as well. So doubt is very manipulative in a way, and it's easy for others to manipulate you with it. At some point, you've got to resolve doubt so that you become decisive. When you're decisive, it's impossible to manipulate you. Yeah? Now, you imagine if you're indecisive morally. Right? In other words, you wouldn't have sex with someone who's not your partner except if they're good looking. Right? That's what you'd call indecisive morally, isn't it? Anything? So what do you think is going to come up in your life through that law of attraction? Lots of good looking people, right? to trigger that emotion, right, who want to have sex with you. And your indecision morally is drawing those events to your life in order for you to work through this emotion. But often what we do is we don't work through it. What do we instead? Oh, yeah, they are good looking, aren't they? Yeah. Yeah, well, I'm now decisive morally and I'll go and have sex with them. You know what I mean? Like, and then I'll maybe even regret it and then I won't tell my partner or whatever else. Now I've made a series of moral mistakes that now have degraded my moral condition, and now I have a whole group of emotions associated with those morals that I'm going to need to release to get closer to God. Do you see the result? Just from one bit of indecision. And straight away I've just made it. And there's a lovely quote in the book The Life Elysian by Robert James Lees where he says, it's amazing how an entire life can be destroyed by a decision that was so small it's like the point of a diamond. Just one little tiny decision and bang, off a person goes down a certain road. Right? And this is where, like if I'm indecisive and I'm doubting, it's so easy to have someone implant in me all those kind of things happening. Fear is another one, is it not? If everyone around you was loving all the time, which meant that everyone around you was willing to hear exactly what you felt about them and about everything that you ever thought about, and they were willing and wanted to hear from you that all the time, and none of them ever had any judgment about that, and none of them ever had any anger about that, and none of them had any, you know, rage and other emotions or shame about that, and none of them ever projected at you when you were in this place of truth and love, how easy would it be to be in a place of truth and love? Wouldn't it be great there? It'd be so easy, wouldn't it? I just go along my merry way, you know, saying truth. You know, has anyone seen that movie where there's a whole world doesn't know how to lie? It was quite funny, the first bit, I thought, anyway. The second half I didn't get connect to very well, but the first part was quite interesting. Like, he's going around saying the truth. Oh, yeah. Do you want to have sex with me? No. Yeah, you're too ugly for me. And you know what I mean? Like, all those kind of things. And the truth was just being said and no one knew how to lie. Wouldn't that be fantastic, right, in terms of knowing and even if my emotions were angry or upset, that would be fantastic still for me, wouldn't it? Because I could be angry and no one's going to judge me and no one's going to criticize me and no one's going to think I'm a spiritual pleb, I'm a spiritual amoeba on the side of a swimming pool just because I'm angry for a day, you know. None of those kind of things are going to happen. Because everyone around me accepts it. Now, add a dose of fear into that little swimming pool of life. Right? What happens now? Now I'm afraid of the judgment, I'm afraid of the punishment, I'm afraid of the different condescension emotions, I'm afraid of the person's returning rage, I'm afraid of their violence, I'm afraid of the potential of my own death. So now how easy is it for me to speak up in truth? Now I'm just like terrified, I'm there shaking, you know, like I don't know how I can do it in this situation, right? So can you see how fear straight away changes the pure condition? Just a little dose of it. And so fear then becomes an easy tool to manipulate. Let's say I wanted to influence all of you to move over near to where I live. Now why I'd want to do that, I don't know, but anyway, let's say I wanted to. What I could do is I could have a whole series of talks about earth changes and how they're going to affect Buderim and the surrounding Sunshine Coast region. Does that make sense? Couldn't I? And any of you who are in fear about all that, I tell you what, your desire to get out of this place would ramp up quite rapidly, right? So can you see fear is so easily manipulated? Down in Coffs Harbour, I was asked the question, what's going to happen to Coffs Harbour in earth changes? I said, I don't want to go to around the world to every town and tell every town what's going to happen to them with earth changes. Even if I knew, I wouldn't tell them. Why? Because I'd spend, how many towns are there on the earth? Like, just particularly on the seaboards of the earth, there's like literally millions, isn't there? And if I was going to treat one like that, I'd have to treat them all like that. And can't you see it's all fear anyway? Like, if I actually trusted my connection with God, I'd know what to do. I'd know where to go. I'd know what to do with my life. As soon as you put in fear, fear is so insidious. As soon as you put in fear, things change so much. Right? And the battle for your soul discussions is not about fear. It's about encouraging you to see the truth of what's happening around you in your life and with spirits, and to start understanding that you're in a battle for yourself, for your own soul condition. That's the real battle. That's, in fact, the only battle there is, really. Right? All these wars on the planet are all about much lesser important things than your soul. And as a result, they are not worth really considering very much in comparison to the consideration you put into the battle of your own soul. So fear. Another one is anger, rage. Another big easy hook, that one, isn't it? You notice that? How easy is it? Like, you know, all the girlfriends get together, you know, for a coffee, right? And one of them starts talking about how their husband for the last 4 nights has demanded sex from them and they refuse to give it, right? And he's got to look at his stuff and he's got to look at his emotions. He's got to look at what's going on with him. And then one of the others starts feeling like some of that emotion within herself. Does that make sense? Like, yeah, these men are just demand sex all the time. And before you know it, the entire discussion is centered around rage towards the opposite gender. Now, by the way, the same thing happens with men at the pub oftentimes, right? So it's not limited to one gender. But what happens is we're then surrounded by a group of people who are in anger. How easy it is for us to connect to our own anger then. Really easy, isn't it? Right? Now you imagine how easy it is to manipulate that from a spirit perspective. Right? Now what a lot of people have noticed is that whenever they get angry with myself or Mary, there is instantly large amount of spirit influence attracted to them. And there is a very good reason for this. There have been spirits, like I've mentioned to you, that for 2,000 years, all they've wanted to do is destroy the work myself and Mary have done. Right? So if you can imagine 2,000 years of frustration in a group of people surrounding the earth, now what do you think they're going to want you to do with that? So every single time you get angry with myself or Mary, whether I've done something evil or not, by the way, it is so easy for another person to manipulate you, yeah, and particularly a spirit. And these spirits are surrounding, the more you come to these sessions, the more they're going to surround you and keep their eye on you. Keep an eye on that one. Oh, there's an opportunity. Ding, 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 ding. Chip away at that one. All of a sudden, that person's in a rage. A lot of barrage comes at me and Mary. They feel very happy. And right. And in the end, they are also happy because the destruction of your soul has begun again. Does that make sense? Every time you hook into this rage and hook into your own rage, you're hooking into oftentimes the rage of others as well. Any other emotions you can think of that are really damaging? Here's one. Shame. And this has been a really difficult emotion for Mary to work her way through because of some of the events in her first century life. And many of the 14, as many of you have met Cornelius now and know that Corny had a life in the first century that was checkered with murders and rapes and so forth, and so therefore obviously has a lot of shame to work his way through. And shame is an emotion that often we don't want to feel at all. You know, it's something, you think about it, how many times in the past, if you had to rate the emotions you feel from your past and the events you feel from your past, often it's the shame-based ones that are the most prominent in your soul. And many of us spend a huge amount of energy avoiding our own personal shame. Huge amounts of energy. The trouble is that every shame-based emotion that's still within our soul is easily manipulated. Just the threat of its exposure will create a whole series of events inside of us that we want to do to avoid the exposure. So for example, if in the past you cheated on a partner and you felt a great deal of shame about that event, you will spend the rest of your life trying to avoid knowledge of that getting to your partner. Right? And you may not even be with that partner anymore, but still be trying to prevent the knowledge of it through the shame. And how does a spirit manipulate you with that? Quite easy. The spirit knows the event. The spirit knows all of the truth about the event quite easily by just reading the aura and the person who is with you, their aura, and knows exactly what happened in that event. And so what do they do with that? All they need to do is just feed the possibility of that event into your partner's mind. Drip, 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 drip. And your partner says, oh, you know, I've often wondered about what it would be like if you cheated on me. And straight away, shame comes up inside of yourself, straight away. And then, you know, what's the tendency? The tendency is to lie again. Can you see? Because you want to keep the relationship together, perhaps, or you want to keep the truth from being known. But primarily, it's because you want to avoid your own shame. You want to avoid the feeling, you see? Now, whenever we try to avoid our own feelings of shame, we have heavy addictions. And in a place of heavy addictions, we are so easily manipulated by spirits by avoiding the issues of shame, personal shame. And the problem with that, the problem with this is that a spirit can just threaten the exposure and you will automatically go into protection mode. And we are often willing in this place to do very many unloving things in order to prevent the truth from being known. Trust me, it is much simpler just to say the truth, because that takes away all those potential events. James, thanks. You just have them up.
I've spoken to a number of spirits who are in a dark place and in deep shame, and feel it so. They're so afraid of their shame that they would rather stay where they are than look at it, and they don't want God to know about what it is they're ashamed of.
Yes, and unfortunately, most of the time is that they don't want other people to know what they're ashamed of, because the truth is, the majority of people, even in the spirit world, do understand that God must know. And so what the issue really is that we don't want other people to know. We're okay with God knowing, most of us, right, are okay with the fact that God knows, but we're not okay with other people knowing. Now, my suggestion to them is exactly the same as my suggestion to the people on earth, and that is, when you are willing to feel your shame and tell the truth about what you're ashamed of, you will find you will release the emotion. Right? Now, I don't know how much my mum would like me to say this to you, but I'll say it anyway. I'm just thinking about my mum for a moment there, sorry. My mother had an affair when I was a child, and I knew about this affair for the entire time she was having it. But she thought she'd covered it over from the whole family. My younger brother, Joel, his name was the result of the affair. And my mum had deep shame about it. So deep was her shame that she was actually willing from that moment on to be controlled by my father in order to avoid the shame. So if Dad said, well, go to bed, she'd get up and go to bed. Right? Now, when I first talked about this with her, she was so ashamed that she cried for an entire week. She just cried for the entire week. She was bedridden for the entire week in shame. But from that moment on, she learnt how to no longer live in her shame, because she'd released some of the emotions. Does that make sense? And so she was, and while she might not be willing to speak openly about it now, she was certainly far more open about it now than ever before. And as a result, is far less easily manipulated by the externals of the event. And that's the beauty of dealing with your shame. Dealing with your shame, you'll find, is one of the most freeing parts of your life. when you actually speak what you're ashamed of, and this goes right down to even your deepest, darkest sexual desires, speaking what you're ashamed of, because most of it, a lot of our shame is result of sexual projections in our life. And when you allow yourself to speak of that freely, you actually become very free, because you deal with the emotions of why you were so afraid. And ironically, in that point, now that you don't have the shame anymore and you're spoken openly, how hard is it for somebody to manipulate you in another area? You see, before then, you can say, oh, I know about something about you, so all I need to do to manipulate you, if you're ashamed, is to threaten me speaking to a third party about it. That's all I've got to do. And you will almost, this is how bribery occurs. Right? Most bribery is by actually hooking into people's shame, and then you can do anything. You can extort money from them for a long, long period of time if you want, right? Until they get sick of it and they realize the shame wasn't worth it, right? And this is what happens, is often all of these emotions are not worth it, but what we finish up doing is we're protecting them, and particularly our shame is a big one. We're protecting our shame so much that we spend all of our life invested in protecting the shame, and ironically, now we are easily manipulated by all external events relating to the shame, right? So can you see it's just a matter of speaking the truth, and all of a sudden anything we're ashamed of will have to be felt, and as soon as that happens, we start moving forward again. Right? If we go over there and then over there. If a microphone that way. And then a microphone there.
Does that truth have to be exposed to who you betrayed?
The truth has to be exposed to the world, which surely would include the person you've betrayed.
Okay.
Can you see that? Can you see that the moment you pass, and this is one of the traumas of passing, the moment you pass, every single thing you've ever done is going to be available to every single person who's already passed. Every single person who comes up to you and meets you is automatically going to see every single thing you've done your entire life. Everything. Everything. Right? Now you imagine if you haven't got used to that emotion before you passed, what that's going to feel like at the time you pass. Can you see how hard that would be? So can you see why many spirits who pass just want to shrink in a ball and go into a corner and stay by themselves for much of their life? They're so ashamed about a lot of their life that they actually want to stay in a corner away from people for the rest of their life. And much hardship in the spirit world in the first sphere occurs because people are not willing to address their shame. Yep. Now, if you're willing to address your shame, you're willing to address it openly. That includes the person that you've betrayed, if you've betrayed somebody. Does that make sense? There is a lot of power in this, both for you and for them. If you release it, you will no longer be carrying it around, and ironically, in that moment, you are no longer able to be manipulated. How easy is it for you to live in truth when you're no longer in your shame? It's a lot easier, isn't it? Like, you know, somebody comes up to you, I heard that you belted your son 21 times in a row. Yeah, I did. We're going to put you in jail because of that. No worries. That's an event that happened in my life. I belted my son 21 times in a row once. He was sticking a knife in a power socket, give him a tap on the backside, knife in the power socket again, looks at me, give him a tap on the backside, knife in the power socket again. We did that 21 times before he didn't put a knife in a power socket again. By that time he was crying. And unfortunately right now Tristan's got an emotion that he's so afraid to act on his desires because of his fear of punishment. Can you see why? Yeah, so I feel that, but that doesn't, if I then feel ashamed of that and I cover all of that over, what happens then? Now that can be manipulated. Does that make sense? By anybody. But now it's just open. No, this is my life. This is an open book. My life is an open book. Do you know that many of the people who people on earth look up to have had terribly shameful lives. Right? The founder of the Lutheran faith on earth, Luther, you have heard of him, yes? His viewpoints of women were terrible. Like, if you could read some of the things he actually said about women, you'd be shocked. In fact, I doubt whether there'd be many Lutherans today, women Lutherans today, who actually wanted to remain a Lutheran if they read what Luther himself had said about women. Now, he is one of my celestial friends. We've spoken on many occasions, right? But that doesn't change the fact that he did these things on earth. And now he's not ashamed of them because he's had to work his way through all the emotions that caused him to do that. Does that make sense? You see, while you're covering over your shame, you are not going to allow the emotion to come up. You're not going to grieve your shame. You're just going to suppress it, control it, keep it under wraps, keep it under control. And unfortunately, it's going to drive a lot of your life as a result. That's the problem with shame. And not only that, spirits can easily hook into your shame. So for example, let's say as a woman, there is much sexual shame in women generally, right? And it's very easy to manipulate from a spirit's perspective, right? All you do is you have a man walking along the road who you drop a thought into, this is the spirit, drop a thought in, that woman's sexually attractive and I projected her sexually. So I might even whistle at her, right? Like, and look at her and say, you know, and then make some comments about her sexual appearance sexually, right? Most women under those circumstances will go into a rage. Right? Many women will go into a rage from that event. Why? Because they are ashamed at some level. Right? That's why the whole event happened. Because the spirit noticed their shame and thought, bit of fun going on here. Right? And off they go. It's so easy to manipulate. And in that moment, the woman going into a rage now just degraded her own soul condition. Right? Now, I'm not saying the man didn't as well, but I'm saying if you're the woman on the divine love path, surely you don't want to degrade your soul condition just by getting into a rage about an event. But your shame is a very easy way to actually have that happen. And if you're not prepared to deal with your shame, and let's generally in our lives we have shames, you know, more than one, right? You think about all the secrets in your family. Every one of them is somebody's shame. And every one of them is so easy to manipulate, so easy to control. In your own families, in the past, you know, your historical families, in the past, many people have made even decisions to kill another person in order for an event not to become known. Right? That's how powerfully manipulated we are with shame. We will even make decisions to stop the mouth of a person who is willing to expose us. Now, can you see that every one of these, in particular, they are like little hooks we've got going out to the world, their expectations going out to the world. And as a result of that, now there are projections coming back to us that will fulfill them in some way or expose them in some way. And we will then work very, very hard in order to prevent them from occurring. So can you see a lot of your life is spent avoiding your fear rather than allowing and going into your fears? So why do you think we have a nice, comfortable home? For most of us, it's because we don't like discomfort, which is actually a fear. Why are we uncomfortable in the bush? Because we have certain fears. Does that make sense? So even just fear is a easily manipulates our life choices even. Most of our choices in our lives are actually not based around love or truth. They become based around fear, right? And in a way to control our fears, to lessen our fears, to make them go away, right? And the same goes with our shames. And our rage is a result of denying even our fears. And our doubts, they can easily manipulate us. There's a nice verse in the Bible that says, "He who doubts is like a boat driven on the waves of the sea, tossed here and there, and with nowhere to go." And that's what it's like when you doubt, when you don't have a direction. You'd be far better off, if you doubt the divine love path, you'd be far better off, and you believe in the natural love path, you'd be far better off just ploughing ahead for the natural love path, forget about the divine love path altogether, than doubting. Because doubting, you won't do either. Do you know what I mean? You just get blown about. Oh, somebody comes along and you do this for a bit, and somebody else comes along and you do that for a bit. And in the end, it results in more and more and more confusion, and more and more and more frustration, and more lack of direction in your life, and everything starts to get muddied waters. And, you know, what's the point in all of that? You might as well make a goal to go for something than actually be driven around by doubt all the time and fear all the time. And these states are so easily manipulated in the battle for your soul. That's the point. That's the point that I wanted to make with you. Okay?
Yep. What was it that degraded Padgett's condition towards the last few years of his life?
Doubt was one of them. Doubt was a big part of it. He doubted a lot of the communication that he received. He also through one of his unhealed emotions, and his unhealed emotion was that he wanted a companion on earth, and he attracted a woman who wasn't interested in any spiritualism truth into his life, and he actually married her. Okay, so he then doubted that Helen, his soulmate, was really his soulmate and so forth. And he didn't allow himself to work through those emotions. And as a result of these specific influences, in the end, we couldn't even communicate with him. Yeah. So it was just a process of a few doubts and a few things here and there not being worked through, and an unhealed emotion regarding the opposite gender and a few things like that. And before you know it, it was easily manipulated. With Judas, many of you have heard of Judas, yeah? The person who so-called betrayed myself. There was a whole group of disciples in the first century who felt that because of my treatment of women, I didn't always know what I was doing. Right? Because I treated women in a loving manner, those male disciples believed that I was easily manipulated by women. Their beliefs about women were that women were owned. Their beliefs were that women were a possession. And I treated Mary, my soulmate, as if she wasn't my possession. I treated her with equality. And they felt that that meant that I wasn't of sound mind when it came to my dealings with women. Right? So they also then went down the track of feeling that I wasn't of sound mind on a number of other subjects too that they disagreed with. One of the other subjects was whether I should be a leader that was established on earth rather than what I was talking about being a leader in the spirit world. And so what happened was that they then took it upon themselves. They treated me very condescendingly, and what they would often do is they'd tee up events. They'd actually arrange events in my life without me knowing. So what they would do, for example, is they'd go to some of the Sanhedrin members and they'd tee up an event. An event might be, oh, if you get together with Jesus and they have a discussion, you'll find out actually that he really does know the truth about these subjects, and he does love you and he does care for you, and you really need to have these personal interactions with him. And so what they'd then do is they'd have one of their number, in one case it was Simon, and Simon gets, you know, he lives near Jerusalem in Bethany, and I should say lived, and 2,000 years ago, and what happened was he had a family and a wife and children and everything, and he invited me around for dinner. Unbeknown to me, there were also like four Pharisees invited around for dinner at the same time, right? And then his wife, because his wife loved myself and Mary, his wife sits me and Mary at a very prominent place on the table. There's this huge table, if you can imagine it. And myself and Mary are sitting next to Simon and his wife, which is a no-no, because the Pharisees should have the first place at the table, right? So straight away they were angry. So this whole event was teed up by a group of disciples who felt that I should have more interaction with the Sanhedrin. And what they did was they teed it all up. And you know what the result was? The result was that because I honoured my soulmate, Mary, and I honoured Simon's wife as well, because of those two things, those Pharisees got up halfway through the meal and left, and they were a key part of plotting my own death after that event. Now, what began it all was three of my disciples thinking that they knew better than myself how to run my own life. That's what began it. Just that. And why did they think that? Because they looked at how I treated women and they thought, yeah, he doesn't know what he's doing there. And they looked at how I was talking about God in the spirit world and they go, yeah, no, we want it to be a bit different to that. And what they did was just manipulate one little event, and yet four people that were a part of that event were a part of plotting my own death as a result of that event. Can you see how easy it is to manipulate something if you're a spirit into something that turns out quite bad? Judas had a whole group of emotions related to that, as did, by the way, quite a lot of other of the so-called disciples, our friends, myself and Mary's friends. And so what would happen is that we often would go into a town with a whole series of events planned that we would have to then counsel. In other words, they'd tee up something for us to do, and we, of course, by this stage, I in particular was in a state where I wasn't going to do anything I didn't want to do. And so I would say, no, well, I never organised that and I can't do that. That would mean a whole group of people were disappointed. But instead of being disappointed with those particular disciples and what they'd teed up, who do you think they were disappointed with? Me or Mary or both of us. All right. And so what finishes up happening under all these kind of circumstances is it's so easy to manipulate a whole series of events where certain people who are in a good condition start getting attacked on regular basis. Does that make sense? Which is the goal of these spirits. And all they have to do is manipulate a few basic emotions. If I had told Judas before his betrayal that he was going to be a major cause of my own death, he would have been shocked. Right? If I had told Peter at the time of my death that he was actually going to rape my own soulmate, he would have been shocked. But that event did happen 3 days after I died. Right? So, can you see? It's just so easy to manipulate things. Now, Peter had huge rage with women. He, from the moment Mary came into my life, Peter was struggling emotionally. He felt that I gave Mary too much credence, too much control, and he felt just my listening to Mary. What would happen is every time a group of people would sit down to talk with me, a lot of times they were men, because women weren't really allowed to do that by their husbands very frequently, right? So often it was a group of men, but Mary always was involved in the discussion, which they resented, right? So they finished up having so much resentment towards my own soulmate that while she was grieving my death, he raped her just to make her feel worse. That was the only motive. Yeah. Huh? And you're not going to like hearing this, but there are a number of men in the audience right now who have identical emotion. Right. So can you see, it's like, it's just a matter, if we deal with these emotions, then we can address them. But the problem was, in the first century, for us, many times the male disciples in particular did not deal with these emotions. And as a result, they were so easily manipulated by a whole series of spirits who just wanted to create a whole series of events. And they were just so easily manipulated that they just went ahead and did those things. Now, Peter is now one of my celestial brothers and sisters. He's a brother, obviously. Right? But he's in the spirit world, in the celestial kingdom. He had quite a lot of emotions to work through to get there. Right? Particularly after the event. Right? And this is why, you know, there is a whole, even like, you remember Picasso, is it Picasso's painting or whose painting, which one is it? Van, no. Which one's The Last Supper? Who painted that? Da Vinci, that's right, Da Vinci. Da Vinci painted the enmity between Peter and my soulmate. Right? Which was what, nearly 1,000 years later? It was known. Right? And the reason why is because all of these events were events that actually happened prior, and they were all events that were triggered by emotion. Firstly, they were triggered by the emotion of the people, the individuals involved who didn't want to deal with those particular emotions. Now, coming up, I've said to you, coming up, things are going to widen with the divine love movement on earth, right? And you and I both know that this is not a cult of any kind. This is actually a way of life. It's a way of life of you connecting with God. Now, you and I know that, but many of you have fears of cult within you. And how easy do you think that's going to be manipulated coming up? Pretty easy, I would have thought, until you deal with that emotion. Many of you feel also worried sometimes about the things that I say. And all I'm doing is being honest with you, but sometimes you go, I don't like that, what was just said there. Now, that's really easy to manipulate that now. Now, I could, as a spirit, easily manipulate that into rage against AJ if you wanted to. Could easily manipulate that into rage with each other if you wanted to, actually. Right? So easy to do these things, you see. That's the trouble, is it's so easy to do these things. And as the movement of the divine love movement, if you like, or the divine love, as God's love, more and more of God's love enters you, and therefore more and more of God's love enters this planet and the condition of this planet, the spirits who are on the dark side want to ramp up their desire to attack that position. And as they do that, what will happen over coming months is that eventually there is going to be negative media attention. You can see it coming from miles off, can't you? Like, and every single emotion that I don't deal with inside of me and you don't deal with inside of you is going to add fuel to the fire. That's what it's going to do. And unless we're all willing to live in a space of love and truth, and we're all willing to deal with our shame, and we're all willing to deal with our fear and deal with our doubts and deal with our rage, it's going to be so easy to accuse this of being what it's not, isn't it? And for other people to believe it. Just so easy.
AJ, I can see where fear and rage and shame come from, I mean, sort of related to our own past experience or whatever, but what's the basis for doubt?
Good question. Doubt is a very interesting series of emotions, right? Because doubt, which is the general emotion, is the feeling I don't know, isn't it? I don't know what to do. I don't know what's right and what is wrong. Can you see where it comes from? I don't know what is right and what is wrong. All right. Now, how do you know what is right and what is wrong? We've learnt how to know, and that is by connecting to God, feeling all the emotions that come up, and after you've felt those emotions, you will know what is right and what is wrong on any situation. Does that make sense? Until that moment in time, you're suppressing your emotions, you don't know what is right and what is wrong. That's doubt, the place of indecision, if you like. So most doubt is caused by our lack of desire to deal with an emotion so that we can know what is right or what is wrong. Does that make sense? And our lack of desire to deal with those emotions can cause lots of trouble in our lives. So my suggestion is with doubt is to write down everything you doubt. Everything. Do you doubt the fidelity of your partner? Write that down. Do you doubt, you know, whether your mother, father loved you, didn't love you? Do you doubt God's existence? Write that down. And plug away through working through those doubts. Right? Because every single doubt is easily manipulated. It's because you don't know what is right and what is wrong. That's why you doubt. You don't want to make a choice. And many times we actually make a choice to doubt so that we don't want to, so that we don't have to face the truth. So for example, our friend comes around and tells us that they saw our husband walking into a motel with a pretty woman, and then they hung around for a while and they decided, oh, we're going to hang around all night if need be. And the next morning, our friend's husband came out, gave the other girl a kiss on the lips and jumped in the car and drove off, right? And she observed all of that, and she comes around and she tells you that, right? Many people in that place will still doubt the truth of what was just told. Why would you want to doubt that? Because you don't want to face the truth emotionally, right? So a lot of the times we purposefully choose doubt, because doubt is a place where we think we can get away with things. Right? In the Robert James Lee's books, I think it's in Through the Mist, it talks about the place of indecision, and it talks about how indecision and doubt can cause so many troubles in our life, and how in fact, in the second book, in the Life Elysium book, it describes the spirits in the spirit world in the hells who purposefully chose doubt in order to avoid their life. They purposefully chose agnosticism, if you like, doubt about all sorts of aspects of their life. And they were in darkness in hell as a result. You see, a lot of darkness comes from our own unwillingness to act. Sometimes it's the people in the hills who have been willing to do terrible things and they desired to do them at the time that progress more rapidly than a person who's unwilling to act. Because as soon as they learn the truth, they're willing to act towards the truth as well. Does that make sense? The people who doubt, who just sit on the fence, are the hardest people to ever move in the spirit world. And many of our philosophers on earth are like that. You try sitting down with a philosopher on earth to try to come to some resolution of what the truth is and see how you go. You can spend days and days and days and days and then months. And I know some people, there are whole degrees on earth about philosophy that teach you how to reason and how to, you know, structure your reasoning ability. Of course, none of it focuses on how to learn the truth from God directly, because none of them want to do that. So what they do instead is they come up with the mind of the human is the most powerful thing, as long as it's used in a logical manner. And so then what we do is we construct all of these belief systems that we philosophize about but never choose. We never choose one of them and act upon them. Do you know what I mean? And often it's our lack of desire to choose something that is because we're afraid of the consequences of choosing one of them. Now, I put to you that it's actually better to choose something and feel its consequence, and then you'll know whether it was right or wrong, than it is to sit on the fence and not choose anything. Does that make sense? You see, the way the universe is created is so beautiful. When we act, we get an instant feedback of whether what we're acting upon was loving or unloving. If there's a painful feedback, then we know it was unloving. If there's pleasurable feedback in a long term for everyone, then we know it was loving, right? So that's our feedback system. We have it, but it depends upon our acting. You see, we can sit on the idea for months and months and months and not act. And this is something I want to probably discuss with you tomorrow about the choices and decisions that you're making in your life. Many of you are being offered these gifts on a daily basis from God, gifts of opportunities, right? And not acting. And the next day goes past. And many of you will never be offered the same opportunity again. Do you know that? For many hundreds of years, maybe, or even thousands of years, you might not get the same opportunity again. Look at the big opportunity. There's an opportunity here for you to be at one with God while you're living on earth. But that requires actions. It requires you deciding and making some choices and decisions and going ahead with some feelings and dealing with different things, right? So isn't that a fantastic opportunity? Like at this moment, there's only ever been one person on earth who's been in that place. Wouldn't you like to be the second one? Like, isn't that a wonderful opportunity? But many of us hear a bit of that truth, and there has been literally over the last, you know, over the last two millennia, literally millions and millions and millions of people who have heard this truth. And not one of them have acted on it till the point of completion on this planet. Not one of them. Right. So there's an opportunity. There's opportunities constantly coming at us. Bang, 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 bang. God's like giving out these gifts left, right, and center, right? And you know what we do with them? A lot of times we don't even notice them as a gift. Oh, that person just tried to control me. I don't go for that. You know, might be one of our responses. Not realizing that we were just offered a gift and we could have said yes. No. You know that movie Yes Man? It's so funny, isn't it? Like, he's saying yes to, mind you, he's saying yes to a lot of things I would have had to say no to because not very loving. But it's just a funny concept, and it's very true. You know, a lot of the times we're denying opportunity after opportunity, and these are all gifts being offered to us by the universe. And what we finish up doing is we deny them because we're afraid of the potential consequences, perhaps. Or to be more frank, we're afraid of dealing with an emotion. Usually that's the whole reason why we deny all these things. So every time that happens, like these spirits noticing that as well, oh yeah, opportunity, neglected that, opportunity. Oh, you see, three opportunities. Every one of those opportunities meant she had to deal with the fear of telling the truth to her family. So if I want to manipulate her, all I've got to do is expose the truth to her family, and now she's in the palm of my hand. I can now control her. So imagine that. If I saw that pattern happening as a spirit. Interesting, hey? Imagine if you were a manipulative spirit or you were somebody who was in a dark condition from a spirit perspective. Wouldn't you notice those events? And wouldn't you go, how can I use that? You know, this is what they do. They go, how can I use that? I can use that. And so, you know, what happens is time after time after time we get the attraction of having the truth, speaking the truth to our family. And what do? We deny the truth or we avoid it or we might even lie. And what just happened when we lied? Down went our soul condition again, right? Can you see how if we're in harmony with love and truth, we will always just keep progressing towards God? But can you see how tempting it is to not be harmonious with love and truth? Little lie here, little thing there, bing, bing, down goes our soul condition. And this is why this cycle thing occurs on earth a lot, where people go all right for a while, get some pretty heavy emotions triggered. As soon as their heavy emotions are triggered, downhill. Does that make sense? And then they go, then they feel all the regret and remorse emotions about that. Then they desire to do that again because they know it's the truth, and so they progress again. And then what happens again? The same issue generally comes up again, confronted, still not courageous enough to deal with that emotion, not realizing the truth even, that God, all of God's laws are built around you speaking truth and living in love. All of God's laws. So every time you don't live in those two places, one of God's laws is automatically broken. And every time we break one of God's laws, there's an automatic degradation in our soul condition. There's an automatic feedback system that we feel inside of us. And we don't realize that, and we don't trust that yet. Because if we did, we'd never break another one of God's laws knowingly. Right? Like many of you know that you have emotional addictions. Many of you are like this with your emotional addictions. What you're doing is you're like a smoker who knows that the smoking is bad for him. Just filled up those lungs with that crappy air, you know, that eats away those little, creates little polyps in my lungs. And yeah, this is really bad for me. I can feel it, you know. It's affecting my jogging. You know, when I go jogging, I don't get a... you know, but it makes me feel so calm. isn't that good? Like, my stressful life is now not feeling quite as stressful, right? And in that moment, what am I doing? I'm just feeding the addiction. Now, I know that it's bad for me. I know people even, I know there's statistics that have been presented to me over and over again that it takes 10 years off my life on the average, like in terms of the longevity of my life, and adds to the amount of disease. 50,000 people in Australia die every year from smoking-related diseases. In Australia, like, so, and I know this, so I say, yeah, but I just can't seem to give it up, right? Why? Because we're not letting the truth of the thing really confront us, are we? Obviously. Now, this is what we're like with our emotional addictions. We're identical to that in our emotional addictions. See, many of us don't want to just go cold turkey on our emotional addictions. You know? What we want to do is have the emotional addictions met. And we say, oh yeah, but I know that if I deal with the underlying emotion that creates the addiction, then I'll be able to release this addiction and it won't be with me anymore. So that's like the smoker going, yes, I'll keep smoking until such a time as I feel like giving up. Now, the chances of him feeling like giving up as he's smoking are high, not very high, are they, really? Right? Because the smoke is feeding the addiction. You see, while we're feeding the emotional addiction, we've got all these spirits around us feeding our emotional addiction. We've got all these people around us on the earth feeding our emotional addiction and keeping our emotional addiction in play. And unless I'm willing to go cold turkey on some of these addictions, I am never going to shake them. Ever. So how do you deal with the emotional addiction of comfort? It's certainly not by having a nice, comfortable house that you're living in and everything's fine, is it? You can't deal with it there, can you? How can you deal with it? Go for a month with a tent, no cooking utensils, just food, and see how you go. Right? No toilet. You got to dig a hole. Challenge yourself with it, in other words. Challenge the addiction. Allow yourself to challenge these addictions. Because if you challenge the addiction, we can often break the addictions. You'll then appreciate the comfort, ironically. You'll appreciate the comfort even more. Because instead of it being an addiction, it's just something you enjoy and you love. And you actually have a feeling of love for that comfort now, rather than, I have to have comfort. If I don't have comfort, one of you are going to pay for my lack of comfort. Rather than having that emotion, you have the emotion, oh, isn't it wonderful? This is so comfortable. Thank you so much. And when it's not comfortable, you're fine because you have dealt with the emotion. Does that make sense? So with our addictions, if we keep going into the space where we keep feeding them, how can we break them? Right? So if one of your addictions is, say, sex with every beautiful person that comes along into your life, if that's your addiction, how are you ever going to break that addiction and find the underlying emotion? It's certainly not by continuing to have sex with every beautiful person that comes into your life that you're actually going to confront that addiction. If your addiction is lying whenever you're confronted with your shame, right? If that's your addiction, how are you ever going to confront that addiction without telling the truth when you feel ashamed? Telling the truth and feeling ashamed is the only way to confront that addiction. Can you see that? And so every single one of these addictions that I have, and this is something I want to discuss with you further after the break, is every single addiction that I have, what is going to happen is any spirit or person on earth who wishes to manipulate and control me emotionally in any way or physically in any way now has an opportunity to do so. Any one of those. Anything. I can be now manipulated and controlled. Now, I don't know about you, but if we really want to express our own free will, my feelings are that we're going to have to learn to have them no matter what anybody else feels, thinks, and so forth about us, aren't we? And if that's the case, then that means we're going to have to shake every addiction that we have towards anybody else giving us anything, emotionally in particular. Can you see that? Vanna, you'd like to? You guys got questions? You've had one for a while?
Yeah, my question is about physical pain.
Yep.
How do you deal with that?
Well, physical pain is the result. Remember, every pain is the result of an emotion that is out of harmony with love. So even our physical pain is the result of an emotion out of harmony with love that we're not allowing ourselves to release. So with all physical pains in our bodies, we need to allow ourselves to tune into those pains. So instead of having the addiction of going to the headache, headache medicine, tablet, or the other addictions that we have, we need to start facing what the pain is about.
I'm talking about deeper, like torture.
In terms of pain,
like fear of physical pain.
Fear of the physical pain. Well, fear of the physical pain is actually what creates the pain.
How do you?
Well, you need to release the fear of physical pain. So the best thing to do there is get somebody who does some deep tissue massage, give you a bit of torture and see how it feels for a bit. And, they're digging in, and you're just there screaming and crying. And what will happen is you'll go through this place of screaming and crying, and all of a sudden now they're still doing the same things, but now you won't feel it as physical torture anymore. You'll feel it even as pleasure, right?
So you had the experience. Is there any way like tune out from the body or?
No. It's the tune out of your body that causes you most of your problems.
So when you accept the pain, it just
when you fully accept
lessens.
All of the feelings and you don't have fear of the pain, that's when the pain disappears. Like, does that make sense? It's the fear of the pain that creates pain itself. Yeah. Yep. So when you're being tortured, for example, and some of you may be in the future, I don't know, who knows? Nobody really knows what's going to happen to us as a group of people or as individuals, just because we're living in harmony with truth or love. But at the end of the day, when you're in a place of atonement with God, you will actually have released all of the fears about pain as well. You won't have any fear at all. So when something physical happens to your body, you will feel it, but it will pass through you and you won't feel afraid of it, which means that the intensity of it automatically lessens. You won't have to go out of body and detune from your body in order to not do it. And you can choose to do that if you wanted to and you know how to do it as well. So there's all sorts of options available to you in that place with regard to the management of pain. Many of us now manage our pain by taking pills or comfort-based things. So the pain of I'm afraid. So I start feeling afraid, cup of tea time. Hot drink straight away. Does that make sense?
What about like a war-type situation? Same
applies.
When a person knows that they're coming for him and...
Why would I be afraid?
Well, if I know how to not feel the pain, I wouldn't be.
Well, wouldn't you also not be afraid if you knew there was, if you actually in your soul truly believed in life after death? Like, if you truly felt that as a truth inside of you emotionally, do you think you'd be afraid about somebody putting a gun to your head? You wouldn't be, would you?
Yeah, but it's not the life after death, it's the pain. I'm not afraid of dying, it's the pain.
It's the pain in between.
Yeah.
And that what I said earlier is still the same answer. Once you deal with the fear of the pain is gone.
Right, thank you.
Yeah. Vanna?
This isn't a question, but I just wanted to say that because I've moved a lot in the last, year.
Yep.
And every time it's to avoid my emotions.
Yep.
And I've been hit with a lot of my mum issues with the place that I'm living at right now. And I've just decided to actually... start owning some of my emotions.
Awesome.
And it's interesting because I'm now only just emotionally getting how loving it is for me to feel my emotions and how loving it is for me to actually be living in a place where I can just express myself.
Yeah.
So...
That's wonderful.
And I think I'm actually starting to let myself feel how much you love people.
Yeah.
And how much God loves me as well. So.
Yeah. And that's the beauty of living in harmony with truth and your emotion. When you actually start acknowledging and feeling your own emotions completely rather than trying to shut them down, that for the first time in your life is the first time you start loving yourself. Yeah. And there's so much truth in that, by the way. So when you're trying to get out of the emotion, avoid the event, you're actually not loving yourself. Like, God's created this beautiful system for you to access these emotions. And it's wonderful that you're experiencing that.
So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. It's really good. Yeah. And what is the time? Yeah, I think it's time to stop for at least a half an hour or three quarters of an hour or something like that, shall we? And then we'll continue this discussion. Thanks, guys.